Welcome to our latest Book Reporter Talks to interview, where my guest today is Jennifer Weiner, and we're going to be talking about her book, Big Summer. So Jen, welcome. It is so nice to see you again. Last time I saw you, we were at Book Expo, standing in front of a large audience. This is even more fun. We're in your closet.
We're in my closet. Yes, it's special. It's special. I've invited everyone into my closet.
Your closet is a lot more organized than mine. I'm taking notes. So Big Summer, we're all waiting for summer. And you know, this book moving up 2 weeks, I'm very excited about it because I am ready for summer. May this do it. We had a little taste of summer this weekend. It got a little bit warm. We were thinking about this again. So tell us about the book and tell us about Big Summer.
So Big Summer is a book that I decided to write when I was feeling really exhausted and really burnt out. And as you know, my previous novel had this very intricate timeline and it took place in cities I'd never lived. It was a tremendous amount of research. And I told my husband, I said, I just want to write something that is fun and frothy and takes place over 3 days in Cape Cod. You know, a place that I know really well, a really compressed timeline, just sort of steering into the fun and fizzy and entertaining. And it turns out that Big Summer had a few more things to say than just fun and fizz and froth. But I knew that it would be published right before, or, you know, sort of before a presidential election. I knew there'd be a lot of noise and everybody's busy. And I figured like, oh, this will be such a nice little respite. It'll be such a nice little break. I had no idea that we would be where we are now. And that the closest a lot of us are going to get to the beach is reading a book like this. So I'm so happy that I can give people this kind of escape and this kind of diversion, because I think we all need it right now.
I was very happy to pack with you, go to the Cape, drive in the car. It was just all wonderful. I can't even tell you. The vicarious experience was right there.
Thank you.
By the same token, you take on a lot of big issues here, which is something that you always do in your books, like friendships, female friendships that can be like little landmines, like, you know, throughout them. So do you agree that life has gotten tougher for those who are not in the popular crowd these days with online and whatever? I feel like it's worse than ever before.
Yeah, I'm going to say that it's worse. I mean, I think that with the internet, we're all supposed to be like, well, on the one hand, but on the other hand, and it can be this helpful tool that it can also, but no, I'm just going to say, as the mother of daughters, it is so much worse. Because when I was a nerdy kid in high school, like I would go to school on Monday and I would hear about like, oh my God, the party on Saturday night, it was so great. And of course I wasn't invited, but I'd get to hear about it. And nowadays, if a kid isn't invited to a party, she can be at home watching that party happen on TikTok or on Snapchat or on Instagram. And it's brutal. And I mean, the internet's a tool, and like any tool, you can use it for good, you can use it for bad, but I really think that girls today, so much more than when you and I were growing up, are really living two lives. There's the true life that they're living, the real nitty gritty, and then there's the life that each and every one of them is performing on social media. Mm-hmm. And they're all navigating that divide between what's real and what they're gonna portray as real.
I feel like right now it's like social media has almost become a weapon. You could weaponize with social media because you don't have to say it to somebody's face. You can just do this picture, you could do something subtle. But yet in your book, we've also got Daphne, who's your lead, primary character. And that part where the grenade is used to describe who she is with this group of people, that's something I don't remember and ever having to be, you know, go through. And it's so devastating for her. Can you talk a little bit about like what that means? Because I was blown away.
Yeah. Okay. So this is sort of the rupture of the primary friendship in the book. So Daphne Berg is my protagonist. She is a plus-size Jewish girl living in New York City. And she has this friend who is basically, she's more or less Ivanka Trump. Okay. She's beautiful. She's well-connected. She has all the money in the world, all the privilege in the world, the best of everything. And she has invited Daphne into her orbit, into her circle. And Daphne kind of can't believe it. And is kind of knows that she doesn't really belong with Drew and the rest of her friends, but is sort of is tremendously flattered that this woman would even think of her, and is also maybe thinking that some of that luster is going to rub off on her. Mm-hmm. So they're out at a bar, they're all home from college, they meet some guys, they're dancing and they're talking, and Daphne overhears one of the guys refer to her as a grenade, which is a slang term for like the ugly girl that you're going to sleep with to sort of take one for the team. Like you're going to throw your body over the grenade so it doesn't hurt anybody else. And she hears that and she is so hurt. And then it turns out that her friend had a hand in arranging that this wasn't a coincidence, that she had sort of chosen this guy, and it's a whole huge mess. And self-esteem is something that I'm always interested in. It shows up a lot in my books. And Daphne's journey is sort of figuring out, is she going to spend the rest of her life trying to fit into that pretty girl mold, or is she going to find a way to live more authentically? And then to get back to what we were just talking about, what does authenticity even look like when every picture is cropped, filtered, retouched, reconfigured, you know, where there's nothing, you know, where every picture tells a lie in a way. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And you've got this great line of hurt people hurt people. Mm-hmm. And it makes you think of trying to embrace being kind, because sometimes the hurting has to be cut down. We just got to stop the hurting. And accepting is pretty key too, but it's maturity that comes in with being accepting of who you are and what you are. And Daphne's moving to that place. She's moving to a place of I am who I am and it's totally fine. And I'm not going to apologize.
Yeah. And I think that once you get to that place, that's when you can go out and sort of embrace other people in the totality of who they are, flawed and imperfect. But it's a journey. And it's a journey that a lot of women navigate in their teens, in their 20s. And maybe it's because I remember that stage of my own life so well, or maybe it's because my daughters are getting there and I can sort of see what's around the corner. But I'm so interested in that journey, in that journey that every young woman undertakes as she's trying to figure out what she's going to be and what she's going to do with herself and how she's going to exist in a world that is still really hard for women.
Yeah, it's really, really, really difficult. Really difficult. You know, you used a lot of D's in this word. We've got in this book, we've got Daphne, Drew, Darcy, and Dora. Yep. I've missed Dora until last night when I was going on and doing notes. Now, was there an obsession with the letter D? And did you know this as you were doing this? Because I was like, wait a second, they all do start with D.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay. So I knew Daphne was the first name that I had, and Daphne, my younger daughter is Phoebe, and Daphne was my runner-up name. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to use it in a book. If I can't like use it for a kid, I'll use it in a book. And then Drew initially had a different name, and Darcy initially had a different name. But as I was going through draft after draft after draft and kind of figuring out how these women all connected to each other, how their lives sort of fit or didn't fit, I did want there to be those echoes there, that sense of like a through line of that we think they're all just very, very different people, but in fact there are some similarities and we don't see them at first, but they're there.
Yeah, no, it's completely there. You know, you also with Drew, she's the classic poor little rich girl. Mm-hmm. She wants a lot of what Daphne has, the Sunday afternoon dinner with dad, blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, her father is this big infidel. We're going to find out a lot about that. And what he's also is, he's also at any moment able to be caught, like these days. What you could have gotten away with years ago, now with social and whatever, everybody can figure out what you're doing at any time. It was a really interesting commentary that you dropped in there about, well, your dad, did you see what he actually did? Very interesting, because now guys aren't safe.
Well, you know, it's also, I think, a question of like how much of their safety depended on the complicity of their partners and the women around them. Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, for as long as there have been men who have cheated, and there have been women who just looked the other way or who accepted this as the price of admission. Mm-hmm. The I want everything that this marriage can give me. So I'm going to put up with X, Y, and Z. Mm-hmm. And again, it's the question of deciding who you are, what you want, how you're going to be, what you're willing to put up with. And I think that what you're willing to put up with is a big question that all of the women in this book have to answer at different points.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and also what we're seeing is not just friends, but family members can give off the wrong signal. Daphne's nana comes and takes care of her one summer and puts her on, like, you know, the non-eating diet. And she just right. and said, this is the right way. You know, we had a family friend when we were growing up, and she used to eat at midnight because that was tomorrow's calories. And if she ate her son's food, I really love this one, it was Jimmy's calories. It was not hers because it was his food. Wow. So the way rationalizing food, did you have anybody who, like, you know, was this kind of obsession in your extended family or family?
It wasn't ever quite that bad, but yes, I mean, I definitely had relatives, you know, saying stuff or, you know, back then, like, little girls were put on diets. And mm-hmm. the way I got a lot of those really granular details was earlier this year, Weight Watchers, or whatever they've rebranded themselves as, came out with an app that's meant for kids like ages 8 to 12 to use to track their food choices. So this was announced, and there was this huge outcry on social media. And there, I mean, first there's all the research that says, like, if you put a kid on a diet, you will not get a thinner kid. You are more likely to get a kid with an eating disorder. Like, that's what that does. It doesn't accomplish what you want it to. But there was this visceral, just outpouring of women who had been taken to Weight Watchers as girls and just talking about the shame of it and how it never left them, how it disrupted their relationship with food and with their bodies forever. I mean, just mm-hmm. the incredible damage that happens. And I don't want to write political books in the sense that I don't want people to come away think that, like, they're being thumped over the head with what I believe or what I feel, but, like, my God, like, if there's a message in Big Summer, it's like, please don't put girls on diets. Like, an 8-year-old does not need to be restricting her carbs. Like, it's no good for anybody.
No, and it totally came through, but I love that whole sequence of what Nana did that summer. I love the way she came back. Now, Daphne's now an influencer. That used to be, influencers used to be high profile celebrities and models, people like that, people who had jobs that were influencers. Now, anybody can be an influencer, can create a profile for themselves without the benefit of a brand behind them. And it's all become not completely about of, you know, they have their own talent. They're creating their own talents all day long. What intrigues you about influencers these days?
Well, it's just what you were saying. It's the idea that it's sort of a platform that's accessible to anybody. Mm-hmm. And people talk a lot about influencers being famous for nothing, you know, and it was the same thing people said about the Kardashians, right? Like, why does anybody watch them? What have they done? They're famous for nothing.
Right.
But what they have done is craft their family and their family's life into a narrative and made it really compelling viewing. And that's what these influencers are doing. They're taking the raw material of their lives and they're turning themselves into brands, basically. Mm-hmm. Like, Daphne's becoming a brand. And hopefully she's trying to be a brand that other brands will want to collaborate with. And it's just such an interesting and such a kind of mercenary way for young women to think about themselves, but it's pretty widespread. And it's also really hard work. Like, I spent a lot of time talking to influencers about how it actually works. And it is a ton of work for very little exposure and very little money, at least at first. Like, the people at the tippy top of the food pyramid are making a fortune. And then there's this huge mass as you go down the pyramid of people who are less known, who have fewer followers, and who are working like dogs to maybe make a couple $100 a month.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that, and it's also that constant connectivity. You're constantly connected. You're constantly going on. I like where you talk about connectivity, giving us a bridge to other people. But at one point, Nick, who is Daphne's romantic interest, he wants her to put down her phone. He said that people are obsessed with their phones. And he says this great line, how are they going to learn to have real relationships when most of their interactions are online? Mm-hmm. How can they learn how to tolerate distress when they can distract themselves with their phones? Mm-hmm. Well, that was a whole hour of conversation about just what's going on today, because there is no getting bored.
Exactly. And kids don't learn how to entertain themselves, because you have like every, you know, you have the world's resources and every fact that's ever been discovered, and it's right there in your hand. I mean, I think that that line actually came from, I'm the parent who goes to like every time one of my kids' schools has a seminar about like digital living or like how to keep your kids safe online, like I'm in the front row taking notes. And I think that that was something that some expert actually said, is like, we have to teach our kids how to have internal resources to distract themselves, to soothe themselves, to calm themselves down, because it's just, we've made it so easy for them. And if they don't have those resources, you know, what happens? What happens the day the internet goes down and it's like, you can't play Candy Crush or you can't go on Twitter or whatever.
Well, and it's also during the pandemic, I think that getting together, we've seen that you're able to connect. Imagine if we didn't have a way to connect with one another right now.
Right.
But you also use something that's one of my favorite tools online, which is the Wayback Machine. Mm-hmm. And she's able to find some clues. I never knew you could use the Wayback Machine for social media.
Oh, yes. I mean, on the internet, nothing goes away. And that's a takeaway from Big Summer too. Like, be really careful what you put out there, because it's not going nowhere. Like, it's going to be there forever and ever and ever, and somebody's going to be able to find it. Yes.
Yeah. If anybody has not looked at the Wayback Machine, Google it, go look up a date on a website, you know, go look up yourself. You'll be really surprised. You know, and about halfway through the book, it takes a direction. I'm not going to give away what happens. Did you always know that that was going to happen? Or as you were writing, this is a good idea?
So when I was having my like, I'm going to write something that takes place over a long weekend on Cape Cod, what I thought about was a real life murder case, which is the Krista Worthington case. And this was a young mother, young single mother, who was living on Cape Cod by herself with her toddler daughter and had been having an affair with a married man who she was in Truro and he was in Provincetown, like, you know, 20 minutes away, was murdered. Her body was found in this little cottage where she was living, and her toddler had tried to like pull a blanket over mommy and tuck her in. It was like god awful, these horrible details of this crime. And the police did not, you know, there was no obvious suspect. And so what they did was sort of go through this woman's history and talk to everyone she'd ever dated, anyone she'd ever slept with, any guy she'd ever met, and in a sense put her character on trial in the name of solving the crime. And this was in the early aughts, this case happened. And the term slut shaming wasn't really around quite yet, but like looking back, like that was really what was happening, is the subtext and sometimes just the text of the investigation of this crime and the way people wrote about it and talked about it was, she was sleeping around and look what happens to women who do that, you know, and she was sort of courting her own death because of her lifestyle. And once I sort of had that in my head, I knew that I wanted to talk about women and reputation. And of course, the Krista Worthington case happened before social media was even a thing, but I knew that, you know, I knew that I wanted that case to echo through the book. And I don't want to give any more than that away. But, you know, so yeah, I did figure out pretty early that there was going to be that element to the story.
No, it's so well done. And it's a direction I don't remember your books taking. So I'm not going to go any deeper on that. Not deeper like the water, ocean, you know, blah, blah, blah. So we'll see. You know, I remember a few summers ago, you were encouraging women to put on their bathing suits, stop worrying about what they look like, mm-hmm. go out and play with your kids. Mm-hmm. Don't take that moment, blah, blah. And it was such a big moment, and you sparked a big movement by doing that. And I remember looking at pictures of myself with my kids or when I was single and through the years. And I was like, boy, I thought I looked bad those years. I'd give anything right. for that body now.
Right? That's the thing. It's like, I just want to tell people, like, just cherish what you have right now, because like, you're going to be looking at those pictures in 5 years or 10 years or 20 years and being like, why did I think I looked fat? Like, why wouldn't I mean, you know, and that's if you even have pictures to look at. I mean, my sense is that, and again, you know, this is sort of ripped from the headlines of my own life, but like, there are lots of women who just don't even want to get in front of a camera ever. You know, like there was like a year after I had my first child where like I had gained a lot of weight when I was pregnant. I hadn't lost it all right away. And I just like would not be in any picture. So there's like a picture of me and my daughter in the hospital. And then there's one from like her first birthday and there's like nothing. So Lucy is just like, where were you? And I was like, well, I was there. I just wasn't there in the pictures, but I was there. But you know, I think that it's important for all of us to sort of, you know, have those memories and be present in our own lives as much as we can. And it's funny, I'm actually working on a piece for the Times right now about how something that I've actually, an aspect of the quarantine that I've enjoyed is seeing some of these news anchors without their lash extensions and with their roots showing and without their like full face of makeup. It's like, oh, that's what's going on under there. Like, and it's kind of nice to remember that these people have real faces, you know?
And they're in their homes. I like to see what's in the background.
Like, I do too. I'm obsessed with like bookcases and like, you know, knickknacks and yes, obsessed.
What's going on in the background? How much was that sculpted as well? You know?
Right.
I remember with my son, I used to use him as a prop. The younger one in front of me here, stand in front of me as we take the picture. Ugh. So that's what we used to do like all the time, which is like terrible. So let's talk titles. Was this always Big Summer? Was that always the title?
It was always the title. I knew I wanted a book that sort of said summer, and I like the idea of it being a little bit of a play because, you know, it's Big Summer because obviously it's very eventful, but it's Big Summer because Daphne's big and she's embraced that aspect of herself.
Well, I've absolutely loved it because I said, this is like the absolute perfect title. And we all want to have a big summer this year. That's all what we're looking for at the same time. Yeah. So you had a big milestone birthday during the pandemic.
I did.
Like, seriously, milestone birthdays should not happen in years like this. It's a very different celebration, you know?
Yeah. And you know, it's like, I'm really trying to be as good a role model to my daughters as I can be. And so what I'm trying to show them is, look, you worry about the things that you have some control over. And once you have no control, worrying isn't going to get you anywhere. So it's like, okay, my 50th birthday, I know you were all thinking it was my 40th, but it wasn't, it's my 50th. And you know, it didn't look the way that I hoped it was going to look. And my husband and I had this like amazing trip to Alaska planned this summer that we're now not going to get to go on because of the virus, but we're all healthy. We're all safe. It's not the end of the world. It's not going to be forever. And we're going to get through it. And then we'll go out to dinner again and go on airplanes again.
And celebrate the 51st. Exactly. You'll be out there to celebrate the 51st.
Yeah, I want a do-over.
Yeah, you want a do-over. I also love reading that your daughters have been helping you with social media and everything that you're working on right now. I love this. Filming, let's do this angle. Who knew?
For a long, long time, their dad and I like really kept them off of social media. We wanted it to be their choice and we wanted them to have some agency and some perspective, you know, enough perspective to say like, yes, I'm okay doing this or no, I really don't want to. So my 17-year-old, my almost 17-year-old, her birthday's in a week and she is just sort of very much like, you know, grumpy teenager, but my 12-year-old's a ham and she like can't get enough of it. Like she has like a fan club on Facebook. It's a little alarming. And she also does my makeup, which is great. She, it's hilarious. Like she can put like false eyelashes on me and like do my brows. And like when I was 12, I don't think I knew what brows were. So I'm really impressed. So
you can hire her out to the Today Show. You can sit there and say she'll come to your house and quarantine there. This is what we can do. I just love that fact. I really do. This is your second book in 2 years, second novel in 2 years. What's next? What are you working on next?
I'm working on the third book of the Littlest Bigfoot trilogy. I'm going to finish that one up. That's my middle grade trilogy, Girl Meets Bigfoot. And then I'm going to think, it's hard to write in the middle of a book launch, and it's especially hard to write in the middle of a pandemic.
Things are blurred.
Right, you know, but I have an idea for what my next adult novel is going to be. And I don't think it's going to come out in 2021. It's probably going to be 2022 for the next one. But I do have just the little baby seedling of an idea. So we'll see where it goes.
Well, I look forward to seeing whatever you do next. I am so glad I got to enjoy this. And I'm so glad that last year I got to enjoy Mrs. Everything with you too, because it was such a big sweeping book. And this was the perfect one to come right after, because—
Wasn't it? Oh, thank you for saying that.
It was just, okay, we knew who those women were, but for knowing those women, you understand these women as well.
Yes.
And I think that that's really important to think about.
Yes.
So you write after the pandemic. We look forward to seeing you, and thank you so much for joining us today. It's always fun. I think the first time we did this was like 15 years ago.
I know. Well, you're very, very welcome. I'm so glad you liked the book. I'm so glad you dressed for the book. I'm really impressed.
Yes. 17 years of Condé Nast. This is what I worry about. What am I going to wear?
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I look forward to seeing you soon.
Awesome. Have a good day. Stay safe. Okay.
All right. Bye-bye now.